Hi Internet, my name is Tim Downs, and in this video I'll show you how to achieve an effect in Blender that is very similar to a major feature of Maya known as live blend shapes. I don't want to get into any sort of Blender versus Maya debate in this video. This is just meant to be helpful and informative to everyone, Maya users and Blender users alike. For instance, if you're only used to Blender, then in this video you'll learn about an old standard method of facial rigging that's been done in Maya for years, but is only just now possible in Blender thanks to geometry nodes. And if you're only used to using Maya, but you're switching to Blender, then you may have noticed the lack of a live Blendshape function, which this video will demonstrate how to replicate. If you want to skip ahead to where I actually start showing that, then refer to the video chapters or just go to this timestamp. Because first, I want to give a thorough explanation of what live Blendshapes are and why they're useful. This is mostly for the sake of all the Blender users watching this video who basically don't know what they've been missing out on. So, what is a blend shape? It sounds a lot like shape keys, which is a feature in Blender. And in a lot of ways, it's pretty much the same thing. It's a shape a model can take by moving its geometry from one position to another. Lots of rigs have facial poses sculpted this way and then have them driven by controllers and drivers. The same thing can be done in both Blender and Maya. Where the big difference lies is how in Maya, any changes made to a shape gets automatically updated to the main model in real time from a separate model. This makes a world of difference when building a face rig for your character. It means you can rig each blend shape target independently and then combine them all as one full facial rig on the main model. It can make weight painting the face an absolute breeze compared to the usual method in Blender of weight painting every single deformer on all those tiny detailed areas of the face. It makes each component of a face rig additive and non-destructive to the main model's entire rig and weight paints. It also means you can more easily avoid ugly linear motions and favor much nicer arced rotational motions. Unfortunately, Blender's shape keys function doesn't have real-time effects, and any Maya user switching to Blender will wish it did since they're likely so used to it. Blender's shape keys aren't quite separate geometries, but instead just the 3D coordinates of every vertex in each shape. So when we set a shape key's value in Blender, it's just a linear interpolation from point A to point B for every vertex. In Blender, point B is a set value. Changes don't happen in real time. That's why we can't make live blend shapes like in Maya until now. Well, it's been possible for a little while now, but I've only seen a grand total of 2 forum posts talking about this, one of which actually refers to the animation nodes add-on, but the same principles apply in Blender 3.0's modern built-in geometry nodes. So, let's finally get started with a little demonstration. Let's create a Suzanne, then duplicate it and set it to the side. Let's call this duplicate Suzanne_TGT, or target, and the first one Suzanne_main. In this, we'll create a geometry nodes modifier and go to the geometry nodes workspace. Add an object info node and set the object as Suzanne_target. Next, add a transfer attribute node. We set the type to vector and the mapping to index. The geometry is the target, but we need an attribute to transfer, which is the main geometry's position. So we add a position node and plug it into the attribute. For this to affect the main model, we create a set position node. Put geometry into the geometry plug and the attribute into position. Now we can start seeing the target affecting the main model. In some cases, this may be all you need, but we can push this a lot further. Having multiple targets affecting our main model simultaneously or additively. Keyword here is add. We could do this with some vector math nodes, but I prefer to have one additional control for this system, which we won't be able to do quite so easily with vector nodes. Instead, you could use a mix RGB node since XYZ coordinates are easily converted to RGB values. We set the node to add and the factor to 1. It goes right in between the transfer attribute and the set position nodes. Next, we plug the position node into the mix RGB. However, as you can obviously see, our main model is twice the size it's supposed to be. This is because we've added its position back into itself, effectively doubling every XYZ value of each vertex in the model. To correct this, we just subtract it from the last node. So duplicate, set to subtract, and plug position in. Now it's back to the proper scale. The reason for doing this with just one target model is so we can drag these factor sliders to get a gradual transformation of influence. Of course, it's hard to do this when there are both separate nodes, so we can just connect them both to the geometry node's input. But for some reason, I honestly cannot fathom, this will only work if the position node is plugged into the first input of our color add node, not the second. One would think it doesn't matter what order they're in since they're just being added, but when we drive the factor with another value, like in our geo node's input, it suddenly matters. If anyone could answer why this is, please let me know in the comments. So, let's add another target to this system. It's exactly the same process, to the point where we can basically just copy and paste everything. Let's duplicate our target and this node tree. Set the object to the new target model, and in our new add node, we replace the position input with the output of the previous subtract node. Once again, it matters what order these inputs are, just like before. And here it becomes apparent that you'll always have this pattern of adding target geometry's positions and subtracting the main geometry's position, because for every target, we have the original position being added to it. This also shows how easily we can simplify this tree by making each of these three initial nodes into node groups. If we attach the group input to the object info node, then when we use this node group, it's easy to just set whatever our new target model is whenever we add a new one. In this example, you can see how you can have this Blendshape system on top of an armature deformation. What's important to note is that this will only work if the geometry node's modifier is above the armature modifier in the modifiers list. Otherwise, the armature will be overridden by the Blendshape nodes and cause odd inverse transformations. That's all fine and good, but so far this isn't very different from regular shape keys. So, I've set up another example with a fully rigged body and a head that has a simple face rig driven by a blend shape with its own separate rig. For the sake of convenience, this is just a Mixamo rig brought into Blender with the Mixamo add-on. But Mixamo rigs don't have facial rigging, so this works great for our demonstration. You can see here I've got the head target off to the side with its own armature. I know it's just the head without a body, I'll get into how that works in just a moment. But if I go to pose this mouth joint I've made here, you'll see it having the same effect on the main model over here. And that's great, but it's not much good to us way over here to the side, separate from the main rig. But that's easily solved by adding a joint to it that drives this one. It's just a copy transforms constraint in this case, but you could experiment with your own constraint setup like copy rotation and copy location. So, why is this useful? Well, this is just a mouth deformation, but remember that this main model's head has no weight painting on it for the face. It's just the head bone that's deforming it, while the blend shape rig is adding that extra influence on the mouth area via geometry nodes. Imagine how much more we could do with this. For instance, we could duplicate the head again, and this time add individual bones for different parts of the upper and lower lips. Since it won't have the same armature, we won't have to deal with balancing the weights between a full mouth bone and the individual lip bones. We also won't get any double transformations if we parent these new bones to the mouth. It's just their local transforms that affect our model, which is why this kind of rigging is most commonly referred to as global and local rigging, where the main rig has all our global controls that are all in a hierarchy from the root in world space. And the blend shape rigs are all based on each bone's local transformations relative to their resting pose. And again, we can achieve much better motions this way with an armature than if we simply used shape keys or static blend shapes without armatures. See how this motion can have a rotational arc? A regular shape key can't do this because it interpolates these positions on a straight path. That's how you can create live blend shapes in Blender like you can in Maya. But for our last trick, I'll explain how I got this head separated on its own and still properly affect our main model. The reason for doing this is to make our scene simpler and prevent any performance issues. Consider how many times you could end up duplicating your model as a blend shape target. This will very quickly cause the file size to grow and cause performance issues in the viewport. Furthermore, if only the face is being affected by blend shapes, then all the additional geometry position info from the rest of the model is useless to us, and it'll just take up more processing than necessary. So, ideally, we just have the head act as a blend shape. The only problem is that blend shapes can only work between models that have identical or nearly identical geometries. Otherwise, Blender will try to match every other vertex in the body to its best guess of which vertex on the head target they correspond to. This generally leads to completely broken models. So, what we'll have to do is make the head a separate object. First, select the head geometry in Edit mode and separate by selection. Duplicate the head and move it off to the side or wherever is convenient and delete its modifiers. Since the head came from the already rigged model, it'll still move as intended when we pose the main rig, but now it has an ugly seam where it was separated from the body because of how the smooth shading is affected by the change in normals. To fix this, we use a data transfer modifier with the body as the source. What we're transferring from it is face corner data, specifically its normals. Right now, it doesn't look right because the only part we need to be affected is the edge loop at the base of the neck. To get this, we select that edge loop in Edit mode and make it a new vertex group. For this, I'll name it neck_loop. Then, in the modifier, use that vertex group as what gets influenced. And there you go, no more seam. And for further optimization, you could delete the extraneous vertex groups from the rest of the rig since they don't have any influence on the head. Just be careful not to delete too many, or you might end up deleting influences necessary to get the head model to match the body's movements. It's best to just delete the obvious groups, like the feet, hands, and legs. Now you can set up the blend shape nodes and still pose the global rig as if it were all one model, keeping your .blend file much more manageable and simple compared to if you duplicated the entire model every time you needed a blend shape. Before we wrap this up, there are a few final things to keep in mind when working this way. Firstly, this system won't work for a rig if you plan on exporting it to a game engine. Unlike static shape keys, a live blend shape won't export properly in any file format like FBX. This goes for Maya rigging as well. There's just no way to write constraints or geometry connections like GeoNodes to a readable format for game engines. Secondly, even if you make the head a separate model, you'll still end up with a pretty large file compared to the standard methods of rigging in Blender. This also applies to Maya, but since Maya scenes can be saved in a binary format, it's much more manageable, whereas .blend files are a unique kind of compressed Python-based format that's almost always the larger of the two. My point, again, isn't to make a competition between the two, but rather give an explanation as to why live blend shape rigging is so common in Maya, despite its substantial impact on file size. Lastly, you may find yourself needing to make some changes to the main model and find that they aren't visible outside of edit mode, or worse, they'll come out looking warped or inverted. This is because the blend shapes are ultimately overriding all of the geometry's position. Any changes you'd want to make to it would have to be accomplished with another blend shape. This could be ideal as a non-destructive way of editing the model, but if you didn't know that ahead of time, I can understand that being a scary or confusing issue to come across. I hope you found this tutorial useful, whether you're a Blender user learning how to rig characters, or if you're a Maya user trying to switch over to Blender. If you have any questions, I'll do my best to answer in the comments. And if you liked it and found it helpful, be sure to leave a like or maybe buy me a coffee over on my coffee page in the description. There, you can also find my latest character rig from Maya, completely free of charge, but you can also tip me as you see fit. Thanks for watching.